Yeah, that's great. Thank you. All right, guys. How are y'all doing? Oh, perfection.
Actually, no.
Okay.
Are you recording?
Yes.
Video on, camera on.
Yeah. Yes, thank you. Bad day yesterday, folks, right? All right, so hey, if you didn't watch yesterday's lecture, I thought it was pretty good. Talked about Daniel Inouye and the 442nd Regiment in Italy, all Japanese American, and this amazing story of this guy. Talked about famous Kanzen and Bob Dole, okay? And so, yeah, so as we're going up through Italy and get to Rome, by June 5th of 1944. Okay, so we've kind of like jumped ahead a little bit, getting to June of 44. So let's pull back and talk about the air war a little bit. All right, and you guys know I don't like to talk about World War II airplanes or anything, right? So here we go. All right, and you have the RAF, which stands for what? Royal Air Force. Okay, they had been bombing Germany from Britain. After the Battle of Britain, right, where you had the German trying to knock them out, and the British survived that. You guys wrote about that on the last test, okay? So they began bombing Germany as early as 1941, okay? And the British got the honor of bombing at night, okay? When you bomb at night, sometimes you can't see your target. So you saturate an area. So another term for this is called carpet bombing. Yes? I don't know if you've heard these things before. Okay. Saturate the area. Now, one way to make your bombs more effective is to use incendiary bombs, ones that will cause fires. Okay. And this is Europe in 1941, 40, you know, early 40s. A lot of structures are made out of wood, so they're going to burn. Okay. And so that is the goal, is to get the Germans to surrender before we have to invade and lose millions of men. Yes?
Yes.
Yes.
And gain air superiority over Europe, okay? So this is a British Lancaster. This is one bomber of hundreds of bombers with one mission. Thank you.
Ambiance.
Okay, so if you look at this, this is a British Lancaster. Let me show you which one that is. Okay, real quick. Here. This is the Lancaster here in the top middle. Okay, yes, that's the Lord Bomber. Okay. This is our B-24, this is the B-17, that's probably the most common plane that we'll talk about over Europe, the B-17, okay? So, you really didn't want to fly this one, the B-24? No. Yeah, they said it was kind of like trying to fly a tank. It was not a good aircraft. A lot of crashes, a lot of accidents with that. This one, though, was really good, and so was the B-25, which we talked about with the Doolittle raid. Yes, they flew those off the aircraft carrier. Okay, so these are the three most common bombers for the Americans, the Lancaster for the British. Okay, this is one plane on one mission. Now, what does anybody know what you call a mission for a pilot? Call it a sortie. Sortie. Okay. So one sortie, one plane. Now there's probably another 100 planes with this one. Follow me? So the first load of bombs they drop right here are a 1,174-pound stick bomb. Okay, so this is a World War II grenade. Okay, weighs probably about 3 pounds. Okay, so you guys have held little dumbbells, like three, four, five-pound dumbbells before, right? Know what that feels like. Okay, there's a little substance to it. So 1170s, and these guys are going to spread out and start firing. Okay, then 108 30-pound J incendiaries. That's these here. So I don't know. I usually work out with 35s when I'm doing curls, but you guys have picked up a 30-pounder before, right? Yeah, I'm more like a 25 guy. Okay, but anyhow. And then, hey, let's throw in a big old cookie bomb, 4,000-pound cookie bomb. This is going to leave a large crater and scare the crap out of the Germans. Okay, so guys, this is one plane, one mission. Now, the advantage you have to bombing at night is that the enemy cannot see you. The enemy fighter planes that would go up to try and shoot you down, they can't see you either. You're not going to have your lights on. Okay, it's not like these things have headlights. All right, they do have lights, but you can turn them on. Yes? Okay. So, this is from the air, from the bridge. Okay. This is anti-aircraft fire. You start shooting because you can hear the bombers, but you don't know if you're hitting anything. Okay. Now, let me show you. I'll talk about the Americans here in a minute. But this is a great graphic that you guys can probably get a little bit closer look if you open the notes. This is the United States Army Air Forces. The proper name is the Army Air Corps. There is no Air Force until after World War II, okay, U.S. Air Force. So all the aircraft are either attached to the Army or the Navy, all right? And so the number of tons of bombs dropped, so 2,000 pounds for a ton, we dropped 1,463,000 tons of bombs in this air war. The British, 1.3 million tons. This is the largest air war in history, and it will remain that. We will never see anything like this again because we don't need all these bombers. We have missiles. You understand? We'll never see this again. All right. Number of bomber sorties. This is how many times flight crews got in a plane and flew over to the enemy. The Americans, 754,000 sorties. For the British, 687. Okay, close to like 1.4 million times we bombed them with a plane. Okay. Fighter sorties, 991,000 for the Americans, 1.7 million for the British. Claimed enemy aircraft destroyed and probably destroyed. So the Americans claimed 35,700 German or Italian aircraft destroyed, the British 21,600. Of all the numbers on this chart, this is probably the least accurate because pilots sometimes are kind of like fishermen. See the size of that fish I caught today? It was huge. Okay. So sometimes pilots exaggerate, all right? Now, this is where you get into some serious numbers, and these are lives, okay? Bomber planes lost. For the Americans, we lost 9,949 bombers. Now, like I said, like with the B-24 guys, a lot of those were to accidents. A lot of them were shot down, okay? For the British, they lost almost 12,000 bombers, okay? On a B-17, there's a 10-man crew. Okay, so if you lose one of these B-17s, chances are you're going to lose 10 guys that aren't coming home from the war. Okay, and we lost almost 10,000 of them. Fighter planes lost. Americans, 8,400. The British, 10,000. With fighter planes, as I said earlier, they're building them throughout the war. So you lose them, you build new ones, okay? And you can build a plane a lot faster than you can train a pilot. Personnel lost in action, okay? And this is where you see the cost of human life. 79,265 Americans died in the air war. The British lost 79,281, eerily similar, okay? So about 180,000 with the Allies. Or 160,000. Bomber planes assigned to combat units. This is a snapshot of 1 month of 1 year. In March 1945, guys, we had 7,177 bombers available to be used against Germany. 7,000. The British in April of 1945 had 7,000. Fighter planes assigned to combat units. May of 45, we had 6,200. The British in August of 44 had 7,700. Now, how many people it took to run this air war? For the American personnel assigned to these combat units, for all these bombers, you got to load the planes with explosives, fuel. You got to repair the planes, all that stuff. 619,000 people to run this air war for the Americans, and for the British, 718,000. Okay. This is a massive campaign. Now, the Germans did it first, what they did to Britain. And it's coming back full circuit to Germany. So German cities all over Germany are going to start looking like this. We're trying to get them to surrender. We're still in Britain. We're fighting our way up through, you know, up through Italy, Sicily, Italy, okay? And a lot of Allied soldiers are dying. So if we can get them to surrender or to give up before we actually have to go in there and fight them in France and in Germany, that's what we're trying to do. And, guys, a lot of times, and this is kind of sad, these B-17 bombers, they would be sent on missions to Berlin, which was the most heavily defended city in Germany, just to draw out the German fighter planes. Because if they saw these bombers coming, they would put their planes in the air to try and shoot these down. By 1943-44, guys, we had long-range escort fighters called the P-51 Mustang. Okay? This plane would have extra fuel tanks underneath the wings so that they could go with the bombers and protect them and make it back. Okay? These P-51s were like angels on the shoulders of these bombers. Because as these bomber crews would describe this, flying over Germany as anti-aircraft fires exploding all around you, and then German fighters come in attacking your plane. It's like flying in a coffin. That's what some of the guys refer to it as. Guys, in 42 and 43, we were losing a lot of these bombers. And then we were sending them over as aerial bait to draw out the Luftwaffe, to get them in the air so we could destroy their fighter planes. Air superiority. If we can destroy their air force, we will control the skies. So, it's not a pretty situation, guys. These bombing crews have to live. Now, this plane is not pressurized. Any guys ever been on a passenger plane? You ever flown anywhere? That's called a passenger plane. Where'd you fly? Did you have to wear a jacket and have oxygen so that you could breathe? Because it's freaking cold, especially in the winter if you're flying to Colorado in the mountains, yeah? Can you imagine being in a plane at 15,000 feet that's not pressurized in the wintertime? You got an oxygen mask, you got this heavy suit on that is actually like an electric blanket, you know, that's in your clothing, trying to keep you warm. It's freaking brutal, okay? If you survive 25 of these missions, you got to come home. That's how bad it was. Okay? You got to come home and teach somebody else how to do it. So, the U.S. 8th Army Air Force, the U.S. 12th Army Air Force, they're going to bomb during the daylight hours, which is definitely more effective, right? Because you can see their targets, but they can see you, okay? So what are we doing? We've got one trying to take out their aircraft, okay? One take out their factories, okay? Take out their oil refineries, stuff like that, okay? Crucial factories. So the Germans start sending up flak. Okay, shove. You guys know what flak is? Okay, basically, it's like this. This is a grenade. This is made out of metal, okay? You launch this up into the air at 15,000 feet and blow it up. It blows up. It's a shell, okay? And it sends out pieces of metal into your cockpit or your engine or into your radio operator or whoever, okay? These puffs of smoke are lethal. And see, I want to show you these videos. You know, I'll get them to you. I'm going to get them to you somehow, somewhere. All right. So the Germans tried to hide their factories. We developed the long-range fighters, the P-51 Mustang, okay? Railroads, highways, anything we could do to paralyze Germany, okay? So we're talking about, guys, hundreds of bombers. And so when these guys would leave air bases in England, okay, they would know how many planes went out. So from one air base, you might have 30 go out from your base, okay? And then from other bases, you know, similar numbers. And then they start returning, okay? And you start counting them, okay? 1, 2, 3, you know, hoping to get to 30. But you come up short, okay? And only 15 come back. You just lost 150 guys, all right? Guys that you knew, guys that you hung out with, guys that you trained with. Now, the people on the ground, you know, they're suffering too. This is war. This is a B-17 bomber. This was taken at Jabara Airport quite a few years ago, okay? Because that's Jack, and he's 20 now. Poor kid, I made him ride his bike. He was still on training wheels. It's about a 2-mile bike ride uphill. Yeah, he's kind of sweaty. But yeah, this is, you know, they used to usually would paint, you know, either like maybe their mother's name on there or their girlfriends or something like that, the pilots. The pilot got to choose the image, okay? Of course, you got a 10-man crew there. This is a great plane. If you got $350 or something like that, these guys come to town, you can go for a ride. Okay? That's on my bucket list. For sure. I'm going to do that. What is this? Let's just see. It's on YouTube, so. Ah. Video unavailable. Okay. Well, then let's go to the next slide. I'll get you guys some video, okay? I promise. On some of the stuff I really want to drive home. Okay? All right. Okay, Germans respond. Holy cow. Okay. How many guys have ever been in the Kansas Cosmosphere? All right. You've seen replicas of these in there, whether you know it or not. Okay, they're hard to miss. Okay, the V1 is this one that looks like the little plane. Okay, and the Germans are going to use what's called a jet pulse engine on the back of this thing. It's basically a flying bomb. All right, and this is leading up to D-Day. So this is really like 1943 going into 44 that the Germans developed these V1 and V2 rockets. Okay. This one is kind of crude, all right? So basically what's going to happen is they're going to launch this thing off a ramp from France. It's going to go across the English Channel. Now, it's going to travel between 400 and 500 miles an hour, okay? And this thing is not piloted. There's not a pilot on it, okay? They tried that. It didn't work. Yeah. When it runs out of fuel, it's going to fall out of the sky. This is a weapon of terror. Because its victims are not targeted, they're random. So today, guys, we have smart weapons. We can launch a cruise missile from 2,000 miles away and hit a target the size of this room, or even smaller. Now, the whole room would, you know, disappear, but you know what I'm saying. This is carrying a 500-pound bomb, and you can hear them. And the British call them, the British always come up with funny things, but they call them doodle bugs. You can hear these things coming across the sky, and there it goes. And then when you stopped hearing it, you knew it would start falling. Okay? And then you would hear a large explosion. So these really, these killed over 20,000 people in Britain. Okay? Now, this is crazy, all right? So we talked about Spitfire. Remember that? We talked about this. How can you forget, right? So if you get the Spitfire going into a dive, okay, you can fly as fast as one of these V1 bombs. And then if you have the guts to do it, you can fly up next to it with your Spitfire and tip the wing of the V1, sending it into a spin into the English Channel before it reaches the island. That's what this picture is. That's a Spitfire using its wing to tip the wing of a V1. It's freaking awesome, right? Okay. Now, the unfortunate thing is, they were sending a lot of these over, so you couldn't, I mean, now you could shoot at them too, you know what I mean? You could use like your 80, like the Germans had the 88, the British had the ACAT guns, so you fire up a shell like this, it explodes, and maybe you hit that, you know what I mean? So it's coming across the sky, and you go boom, 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 trying to hit it, okay? Blow it up in the sky. And they were able to shoot some of them down as well, okay? But a lot of them made it through. Now this one, you're not stopping. Today, you might have a chance of stopping this, but not in 1943-44. This is the V2, okay? And it traveled faster than the speed of sound. So you would not hear it coming. Okay? So there was no way of stopping these. These were random as well because they didn't have guidance systems on them. You know what I mean? So the Germans figured out. Now, you guys know who was working on this one right here? Who was the lead scientist engineer on this? The V2 rocket. You guys know any of this history? A guy named Wernher von Braun. Okay. And after World War II was over, the United States made sure to capture Wernher von Braun. Because of his inventions, a lot of people died in World War II. But because of his technical knowledge and expertise, he helped us put a man on the moon. After World War II, we captured him. He went to work for NASA.
Was he even a prisoner?
Nope. Some people have a problem with that. Okay. 4 minutes, 3 minutes. I'm pulling up some V1 videos. V1, V2.
We get out at 35.
Yeah, we got 3 minutes. What's it say? I have 20 minutes?
Yeah.
All right. What's wrong with my freaking computer? Yes.
Did he work openly with the Germans or like reluctantly? Like,
I mean, yeah, it was his job. You know what I mean? Like, so
he didn't really care about it.
Right. It. I think you cut him a little bit of slack, okay? What's this? This looks pretty good.
In 1942, the Luftwaffe, aware of the development of a long-range rocket by the German army, began intensive development of a rival weapon, a ramjet flying bomb. The flying bomb entered service ahead of the Army's rocket and became known as the V1. Launched from ramps situated in the Havre de Calais, flying bombs were used to attack London in an offensive that commenced on June the 13th, 1944. Basically simple in design, the flying bomb was an economical and effective weapon of war. Traveling at speeds of up to 440 miles per hour, it severely tested the air defenses of England.
In early
September 1944, the flying bomb launch sites were overrun by advancing Allied armies. In a three-month offensive, the bombs killed over 5,000 Londoners, maiming and wounding many thousands more.
Stop. Okay. This one is the sound.
Shop online and sign at home.
Doodlebugs. Here's the V2.
You are watching captured German films of the top secret Nazi research center at Peenemünde, a base on an island in the Baltic Sea. It was here that German scientists developed the first rocket to travel faster than the speed of sound. When it was unleashed on London, it gave no warning of its approach. You heard the explosion before you heard the sound of the missile. The results were devastating. Leading the German research was Wernher von Braun, a scientist whose passion about space exploration was exploited by the Nazis. Years later, von Braun would work for NASA on the Apollo missions, but now, his focus was on London.
That one didn't work.
The German project had its share of successes and failures. As can be witnessed here, the 2,000-pound warhead could cause a great deal of damage. At first, London felt its wrath, but now individual rockets had names such as Washington, D.C., Philadelphia, and New York. Those were the ultimate targets. It was only a matter of time before the range of the rockets would be extended from across the channel to across the Atlantic. But Allied bombing combined with the loss of launching sites in Western Europe following the D-Day invasion doomed Germany's chance to maximize the use of these weapons of terror. Hitler believed he could salvage the war with these rockets. More than 10,000 were fired at the Allies. They did cause initial panic to Londoners when first introduced, but they had little military impact on the course of the war. For the Nazis, it was too little, too late. For them, the war simply ended a year too soon. But with the war still raging in the Pacific, an old weapon was making a difference by being used in a very new way.
Okay. There you go. That was pretty good, huh? Yeah, so they do have replicas of these in the Kansas Cosmosphere because this was a really kind of a huge stepping stone for, towards space travel. Okay. I thought I was running out of time, but I'm glad I'm not. Okay. So, here's some more pictures. Okay, so you can see a V1 coming down here, and then the kind of the aftermath of the explosion. And then this is the effects of a V2 rocket. I tell you what, it's a few years ago, probably more like 18 years ago, I used to have this link, this recording, this little British girl. One of the worst attacks was hit like a Woolworth store. One of these V2s hit a Woolworth, and this little girl was telling the story of what she saw in this, you know, cute little British accent, you know, and it was on the Imperial War Museum's website, and then they took it down. I've never been able to find that again, but she describes kind of the scene here of what happened with the bomb, the V2 guy. They were devastating.
What is that about?
Rock'em Sock'em Robots?
Just like an intermission type
thing. Yeah, it's just lighting things up a little bit. You know, when I was a kid, I played with those, and then when my kids were kids, they're still kids. But, I bought, because it took me back to my day. You know, that was around when I was a kid. And you guys ever have that, Rock'em Sock'em Robot?
I saw the commercials. My brother
mm-hmm.
just
like,
pulled
a controller thing and break it. I would imagine. Okay, here we go, guys. Here we go. Big day right here. D-Day, right? There's my thing. Okay, so June 6, 44, okay? 6-6-4-4, okay, June 6th, all right? Now, the idea here is to cross the English Channel and defeat the Germans, okay? Now, I got to do some stuff here. I got to do some prepping here. I got time. Why not? Heck no. All right. Give me a second. I'm going to break out some old technology here. That's right. Oh, yeah, you guys ever seen one of these?
Yeah.
That's all I ever used to use.
Yeah.
Oh, that won't fit. Oh, gosh, you gotta unplug something.
This is really. Really weird.
This is cool, isn't it?
It's kind of making me
uncomfortable.
What do you mean? It's nostalgia.
It's just like weird.
I really don't want to erase this.
Don't erase it.
It's going to jinx us if I erase that. Okay. Check this out. Hello. That doesn't seem very bright. Can you see that?
He's getting a little bit older, Mr. Ebrag. You should give her the break.
Maybe this is dirty. Yeah, I have stuff. I stole this one from Davidson when my bulb went out. It's not right. Come on now. Not really, really.
It's okay, you can see it.
Okay. Okay. Okay, here we go. That just stinks. Okay. All right, so here's England, right? Here's France, yes? What's this body of water? The English Channel, okay? The narrowest point here is at Dover, England, or this region of France called Pas de Calais. What? It stinks too, doesn't it?
I can smell it.
Maybe if I do this.
Probably burnt that.
What a crap show.
Oh,
you're trying.
Why is it wheelchair?
I don't know. Okay. So I'll have to draw it.
Starting over?
Slow down. Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, I see the English channel.
This is the water.
Yeah.
Look.
Long water.
Water.
Right? Oh, no.
Dover. Hot day. LA. Okay. Narrowest point. 20 miles. Okay. It's important. All right. Now. So. Gosh darn it. All right, let's establish something. What in the world does D stand for?
Day.
Why are you laughing?
Is it day?
Yes.
What is
it? H. What's H stand for? Okay, it could be like B day or J day or K day, but it's D day. It's the day. H is the what?
Hour.
Now, guys, going back in American military history, you go back to the War of 1812. They started using D day as the distinction for the day of an attack. Without saying the date, so that, like, ears, you know, wouldn't be listening and you'd give it away in secrets, right? So they used the term D-Day for the day of an attack. But, guys, this was the D-Day of all D-Days, you understand? So it's like a nickname that stuck. It's not Destruction Day or Doomsday. It's Day-Day. And the H hour. So D-Day is June 6, 1944. Okay? Does that make sense? A lot of people don't know that. Okay. Now you do. All right. Now, the overall operation is called Operation Overlord. Okay. In charge of this mission is General Dwight David Eisenhower, the Supreme Allied Commander, Ike. Okay. I've talked about him a couple times now. The planning for this has been 4 years in the making. And the Germans, guys, have had 4 years to fortify this coastline, okay? And we know it. We have spies over there. We're taking aerial photography over there, okay? The most heavily defended area of the German Reich is there, at Calais, where it's 20 miles, okay? So the goal here, guys, is to try and get the Germans who are building this Atlantic wall. So I'm gonna do a Ziggy line here. This is the Atlantic Wall, okay? The goal is to make the Germans think the invasion is coming here. But in reality, the invasion will take place here, at a place, a region of France called Normandy. Normandy's not a town, it's a region. Like Calais is not a town, okay? There are some small towns in it. Okay, so how do we make them think that, okay? Well, we're getting help from the French, some of the Free French, what we'll call the French Resistance, okay? They are going to help on the day of the attack. So one of the things the French can do for us is destroy telegraph lines, phone lines that go from the coast back to headquarters. So the Germans have all their reserves back here. Rommel, remember him?
The Desert Fox?
Yep. And then another guy named Rundstedt are back here. And they have tanks. Okay? And so if the tanks need to go here, they go here. The tanks need to go here, they go there. But they're all in the rear in reserve. So we want to cut the telephone lines. We want to cut the railroad cars that would be using the railroads that they would be sending troops in from the rear, okay? So that's what the French are gonna help us with. They're also gonna help with landing zones for paratroopers. the light landing zones where our paratroopers will come in. You guys know what a paratrooper is, right? Yeah. All right, let me show you some more. I'm going to scour the school for a bulb. Now, this is Operation Fortitude. Okay? This is the operation to fool the Germans, to make them think the attack's coming here. Okay? This is an inflatable tank, like a raft. This is artillery made out of plywood. They're going to build fake ammunition dumps, hospitals, all this fake stuff, and bring it to Dover. In fact, they're going to bring the most feared American general to Dover. George what? Was in the lecture yesterday.
Patton.
Now, guys, General Patton has time on his hands. General Patton was leading the U.S. First Army in Italy, Sicily, North Africa, yes? And he was kicking butt. But while he was visiting a military hospital there where guys like Bob Dole and Daniel Inouye were laid up, he was placing Purple Hearts on those soldiers. It's just a somber moment. They've got the media's there, the doctors and nurses, the three-star general comes in, and he's pinning and talking to these guys. Some of them are going to make it, you know. It's kind of a somber moment. He gets this long tent of guys in beds, you know, all bandaged and stuff. He gets to the end of the medical ward, and there's a soldier in uniform sitting at the end of the bed. He's got his head in his hand like this, but he's not wounded. And Patton comes up to this kid. Patton has these black leather gloves, and he took them off. He's got them in his hand. And he looks at this soldier. He says, "Soldier, what's going on with you? Why are you in here?" And the soldier's kind of weeping, saying, "You know, General, sir, I just can't take it anymore." Patton takes these leather gloves and just smacks this kid upside the head. And you can hear a gasp in the room from the nurses and the doctors and the media. Now, this guy's probably got post-traumatic stress, right? He's shell-shocked. Like, physically, he can't, you know, mentally, he can't take it anymore. Patton's an old school guy. He starts ripping into this kid. He says, "You need to get up. Look at these guys over here. These guys are sacrificing. You're sitting in here saying you can't. You're going back to the front line." Well, word starts to leak out about this. Gets through the media. Gets back to Eisenhower. And he's got a public relations problem here with Patton. So he takes away his army. He doesn't fire him. But he takes away the First Army from it. Devastating for Patton. So he's got time on his hands. They send him to Dover. They put it all in the newspapers. Patton arrives in Dover. Okay? So the Germans think, well, that's where Patton is. That's where the attack's going to come. Tune in Monday for more. Okay? And I'll find a way to get you guys some good video on the air war and Guadalcanal and other stuff. Okay?
Have a good weekend.
Have a great weekend. Got some good weather today. Peace. I got it.